Hello, welcome back. I will now discuss moral dilemmas and situations of moral overload. Moral problems in science and technology often take the form of a moral dilemma. And we think it is important for a better understanding of responsible innovation that you become acquainted with some of the peculiarities of moral dilemmas. I hope to show how innovation and design may be a way of dealing with moral dilemmas. Scientists, engineers, and designers often feel the obligation to make the world a better place, to make the world safer, more sustainable, while creating new jobs, while protecting privacy and fight terrorism, to give autonomy and freedom to future users and quality of life to future generations. They want to achieve all of these things, and as many people who want to do the right thing, they encounter the problem of moral overload. The problem that there is just too much good to be done, and that we have too many obligations that we cannot fulfill. We want economic prosperity and jobs for all and sustainability. We want value and privacy and security. We demand safety, but we do not want to pay too much for it. We require accountability, but we want confidentiality as well. But this is a very difficult situation, as you will see in the examples in the next slides. CCTV cameras, privacy or security. Nuclear power plants, secure energy or safety. Drones, do we still feel accountable for our actions? Dilemmas such as these are the paradigm case of a moral problem. Someone who confronts a dilemmatic situation typically has two obligations, but can only fulfill one of them and not both of them at the same time. There are two views of dilemmas. The first view is that the alternative that you end up choosing on a balance of good reasons is your true moral obligation. The other obligation for a moment just appeared like a serious moral contender, but turned out after deliberation not to be among the things that you were obliged to do. So the dilemma evaporated. And one could say they do not really exist, they only appear to exist. What seems to be a situation of conflicting obligations is just an apparent dilemma. The second view of moral dilemmas holds that both options are genuine obligations and exert a moral pull on us, and they keep exerting this moral pull, whatever we end up choosing on the best of moral reasons. According to the second view, both options can be genuine obligations between which we must choose. The problems with this view are twofold. First, it seems to be inconsistent with a very plausible general moral principle of ought implies can. This principle tells us that it only makes sense to speak of a moral obligation for someone to do A if that person can do A. So if we have an obligation to do A and an obligation to do B, assuming we can conclude from this that we have an obligation to do both A and B, then we must conclude by applying the principle ought implies can that this only makes sense if we can do both A and B. The nature of a dilemma, however, is precisely that we cannot do both A and B. There's a second problem, which, by the way, also applies to the first view on dilemmas. And it concerns the question why we often experience remorse or regret for not being able to do the other thing that we were obliged or appeared to have an obligation to do. For the first view, it poses a problem because we should expect that there is no regret or remorse over the road not traveled. That is just not our obligation. The psychological facts are usually different, however. And we often do feel bad about the lives we were unable to save, the animals we could not rescue, the CO2 emissions reductions we could not achieve. Even if we know we did the right thing, we may experience these feelings. For the second view on dilemmas, the fact that we cannot do both A and B at the same time should help us to relativize our feelings of having failed and being blameworthy in a sense. But this also doesn't work. The philosopher Ruth Barkin Marcus has proposed a view of this moral residue or residual regret that I believe is very relevant for our topic of responsible innovation and may offer a solution. Barkin Marcus suggests that if we have an obligation to do both A and B, we have a second order obligation to see to it that we can indeed do both A and B. I have termed this second order obligation a meta-task responsibility. A meta-task responsibility is an obligation to see to it at time T1 that persons, yourself or others, can do what they ought to do at time T2. If we accept this idea of a higher order obligation, we can see how the fact that we have not succeeded, or not even tried, or not even thought about trying, gives rise to feelings of regret and guilt. It leaves us with a moral residue. Do note that this obligation is not subject to the principle of ought implies can. It may turn out not to be possible to realize a situation where both A and B can be done. This meta-task responsibility to see that one can do what one will be morally required to do at a later stage is the obligation that we implicitly endorse and mentally focus upon when we feel that we have failed from a moral point of view in a dilemma. The moral force, both ex ante and ex post, of the sheer possibility and the opportunity to explore the possibility of changing the world in such a way that our obligations become co-obeyable and our responsibilities co-satisfiable, can act as a driver of innovation, invention, creativity in engineering and design. So instead of changing our values, ranking our obligations or reducing them to one value and metrics, we are encouraged to bring about a new state of the world, which allows us to eat our cake and have it, to square the circle and satisfy all of our obligations at the same time. It prompts us to solve the problem of moral overload by innovation. Let's look at the example of smart meter design. Smart meters are a good idea. They help us in becoming more sustainable. But people also have been worried because of the privacy impact. We have to design meters that satisfy all functional requirements and serve sustainability, and in addition, they need to be privacy respecting. The dilemmatic structure of our problem in smart metering is as follows. The shaded area is the area that we are interested in for our ideal moral solution. Here we satisfy both of our values above a certain reasonable threshold level, let's say. A first generation smart meter may neither get us the desired level of privacy nor the desired level of sustainability. The smart meter 2.0 may give us one, but not both. The smart meter 3.0 is what we are looking for, of course. The really smart meter is designed to accommodate both functional requirements in order to make the management of the grid more efficient and protect personal data pertaining to electricity consumption in the household. It gives us privacy and sustainability. Innovation in smart metering in this respect is exactly this: the reconciliation of one smart design of a range of values or moral requirements, some of which were actually in conflict before. If we would like to benefit, for example, from RFID technology in retail, but fear situations in which we can be tracked and traced throughout the shopping mall, it has been suggested we can have it both ways. A so-called clip chip in the form of a price tag with clear indentations would allow customers to tear off a piece of the label and thereby shorten the antenna in the label so as to limit the range in which the label can be active and transmit data. The reading material provides you with more examples of how to take moral obligations towards customers, future users, future generations, climate, animals, serious, and confront difficult moral choices, not by compromising on your value commitments or doing more philosophical homework, but by changing the world by applying your creativity, knowledge, and skills. Dealing with moral dilemmas stimulates creativity and innovation and may help us to overcome problems of moral overload by innovative design. Thank you for your attention and good luck with your next assignment.